بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم، أما بعد. First of all, we would like to thank all our participants for today's monthly talk session. This is going to be our eighth monthly talk session. Alhamdulillah, by Allah's grace and all your support, we have till date done 7 members talk session. I would like to call upon Brother Nadeem to recite few verses from the Holy Quran so that we have the mercy of Almighty. Over to you, Brother Nadeem.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والتين والزيتون وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين لقد خلقنا الإنسان في أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فلهم أجرهم غير ممنون فما يكذبك بعد بالدين أليس الله بأحكم الحاكمين صدق الله العظيم.
Alhamdulillah. May Allah shower His blessings on us. Dear members, as you all know that, by this time, what exactly the format we generally follow in our members talk session, just for good order's sake and for the benefit of new participants, if any, I thought I would just share it. We will ensure that a monthly update is given on what your chamber has done by none other than our president, post which we will have 4 presenters. 3 from the corporate side and 1 from the educational institute. See, all these presenters will take 12 minutes to 13 minutes to give their presentation, and after which we will have 10 to 15 minutes as per the time, a session for question and answers. With that, without taking much of your time, I would like to call upon the president of UEF, Ahmed Buhari Saab, just to share some of the key highlights of what we have done for this month. Over to you, president.
Thank you, Khalil. Assalamu alaikum, everybody. So, always nice to see all of you. Thank you very much for joining us. I'm happy slowly the headcount of participants is slowly increasing. We would like to have, obviously, a lot more people participate. So, before we start, we've got 4 very interesting speakers today. And as you can see, we are trying to get more and more ladies and more influential ladies like Batul coming and presenting. I hope we have more of them as we go forward in the days to come. So we've got South India Shelters, we've got the Mecton Group, we've got Wings Food, and we've got the Master Group. And these are the 4 presentations. My request is if we can try to keep it about 8 to 10 minutes, that would be very helpful. And then we can just have a little bit more time for Q&A and whatnot. So Kaleem, just put up what has been the activity last month. Right, so this is the update. Sometimes when I see this list, I also get pretty impressed. I know I'm an interested party. I shouldn't be saying this. But, the type of activity that we do and the reach that we have, it's always very interesting. So our team visited the Trichy area and they had some very interesting meetings with MAMSET, with MAMC, with this MAM group, Jamal Muhammad College and the MIT College, MIET. I always thought it was MIT, but I realize it's MIET. And I think they had some very good discussions. I think particularly they were impressed with the Master Group, MAMSET, the discussions. And of course, Dr. Abulhasan has been our real star. Every month he seems to be getting some award or the other. So congratulations to Dr. Abulhasan for the COVID care initiatives in the hospital. UEF also had invited Islamia College to come up with, to visit our Crescent Innovation Incubation Center. I'm also very happy to tell you, yesterday or day before yesterday, Crescent, our B.S. Abdurrahman supported Crescent, got the credit from Government of India for 2.1 crores for setting up the Asia Center. So, as you all might remember, this is a 5 crore grant that Crescent has got, and it happened fairly fast. I think, this is within 6 months of application, I think we got it. For those of you who remember, Mr. Deepak Bagla is the CEO of Invest India, which is the Government of India's Investment Promotion Board. He was a speaker in our World Summit last year. And we have been very closely engaging with him. And first to make the application was Crescent. It's not because it is our group, they applied. It is open to all our educational institutions. But we have been pushing very hard on Crescent. I'm not able to push the other Asias as much as I'm able to push Crescent, as you can imagine. And so thankfully we got the grant of 5.1 crores post the World Summit, post the application of Crescent. So it has come in, and it's to me, I think it's very significant for our whole educational institution initiative. Because I still remember Nizambhai was mentioning, I think when we had a call some time back, that 5 crores can possibly help 50 companies to give, you know, seed capital of maybe 10 lakhs each. And imagine the amount of, the number of companies we can start with this type of grant. And so we are very happy that we got it, and we're really hoping that all our education institutions will eventually be getting not just 5 crores, maybe 10, maybe 20, maybe 30, 40, 50, 100, whatever it is, which in our humble opinion will be of phenomenal value to the entire community. Then of course, Whiteleaf Ventures, promoted by our Asif Bhai, Nawab Zada, they have signed a MOU with Government of Tamil Nadu for exporting Avin milk products. And KKSK Rafiq has supported COVID care, 100 oxygen concentrators, and MAMSET has come forward. I mean, of course, they have set up, MAMSET has signed an MOU with IIT Research Park. Hearty congratulations to them. And so 1.5 billion, I think Batul will be the one who's going to really set the stage and, you know, inspire all of us, you know, to do something very interesting. And of course, UEF organized a business matching meet. I think we had done it over the last month. I hope it was useful. Dr. Nawaz was there. A whole lot of other people had participated from, you know, so we try to do a matchmaking, you know, so that UEF members can collaborate with each other to do more things. So this is roughly the activity of August. So this was the whole of August's activity. And inshallah, maybe September and the year onwards will also be very interesting. So that's it. I have nothing more to say, and I'll pass it back to Kaleem. And congratulations to everybody who's speaking today. Thank you all for participating. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. Thanks for the update, President. The first presenter for today is going to be South India Shelters, familiarly known as SIS. You know, to describe this company, I would say that land is a very limited resource that Almighty has given to us. But this company works on turning lands into landmarks. That's what they say, turning land into landmarks. A company that was established in the year 2002, having 2 decades of experience. In these 2 decades, they were able to build 3 million square feet of build-up area with approximately, if I'm right, close to 1,800 to 2,000 customers, happy customers. Believe me, if you go and see their site, any of their site, not particular to Guru Anjali or any other site, any site you go, one thing that you will say utter is wow or mashallah. Known for their meticulous design, luxurious and spacious lobbies, corridors, and known for the quality that they deliver. I would like to call upon the founder and managing director of South India Shelters. It is none other than our eminent member, Muhammad Ali Saab. Over to you to share about South India Shelters, Ali Saab.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, thank you very much, President, and thank you, management, for giving me this opportunity to talk about my organization. About South India Shelters Private Limited, it is a family-held company with 4 brothers. And basically, my name is Muhammad Ali, and I'm a civil engineer. And then I did my post-graduation from BITS Pilani. Then I started small projects on contracts. We started from the scratch. My father was a doctor. We never had any experience of business in the past generation. So ours was the first generation in the business. So we had our own struggle and things like that. And then we started with small constructions. Then 2002, we got into development. That is where, like, all the four brothers, we together, you know, we started this company. It's a joint family. Ours is a joint family. So everyone had a different expertise. So we pulled in everything. And our first project was SAS Meridian in Velachery. That was a flagship project. And it was an MSB project. First, one of the first MSB buildings in Velachery. Today, Velachery is like, it's a very, very developed area with Phoenix Mall and many other developments. And now it is 18 years, still the project stands out to be one of the best. So then from there on, you know, we continue doing projects. We always go to peripheries, take up a bigger chunks of land, like 3 acres, 4 acres, give value addition. And my clients, over a period, you know, they get the appreciation of the property, because when we develop, it will be like a developing area. Once we complete, it becomes a developed area kind of a thing. So my clients are always happy, alhamdulillah, they're all happy, and we are getting good reviews from our clients. So we are happy about that. So I will share my screen to talk about my project. So there are a few projects I can show you, but they're all like, you know, big projects, like 400, 500 apartments. Firstly, I will go through this completed projects. This is called SAS Safa on Gudvanjeri. Always, as I said, always we go to the periphery and then develop, so that we can give them a lot of amenities for a lesser price. Like Sharif Bhai said, definitely, you know, see, we give no good quality. They're all actually completed projects, actual pictures, what you see. You can see the handwork and all those. They're all handmade with special masons. This project is called Marrakesh, based on some Moroccan architecture, a touch of Moroccan architecture. But this is really like a resort. When people, they come back from the work, it will be like they're coming into a resort. And this is our first project, I told you, flagship project. I don't have a good elevation of this project right now, but you can see the interiors. You can see, like Sharif Bhai said, you can see the corridors, 9 floors. All the floors will have these big corridors, separate entrance. And so we did mainly we focus on common area, because apartment is there where what they live. So they can do whatever they want. They can do interiors to their taste, but the common area nobody bothers. So what we do is, you know, we give importance to the common area, wide lobbies, big corridors, and then big lobbies. You know, even though it is like, you know, less priced, you know, we give granite cladding to our lift area and all those things. I'll just rush through, because this is our SAS Queenstown in Gudvanjeri. No matter we go to Gudvanjeri or Trichy or whatever place, but we focus on good buildings. And this is, you'll be surprised, this is an affordable project. So we have flats from 30 lakhs to 45 lakhs or so. Even if it is affordable, you know, my client will be like, you know, he'll be so happy to enter into this building, because, you know, it looks so good. So we concentrate on all these elements. And this is one of our layout project in Ambattur. So we have almost done. These are all running projects. And this is a project in Trichy. 680 apartments. We are doing it in 3 phases. It took quite some time. But you can see this is an actual picture. You can see how much we have spent on this building. And these ornamental columns, what you see here, they are actually, there are 350 columns in the building, only for architectural beauty. So this is going to be there for like 100 years. So we focus on the buildings. And this is an indoor swimming pool in Trichy, because ladies, when they want, you know, they can have timing, they can also enjoy. So this is the exterior of it. And this is a small project we are doing in Saligram right now. And we also, a part of this 100-acre development by ESR in Oragadam. We actually acquired some property of around 45 acres, but these people, they came and they wanted to buy the plot, and we said no, we are interested in joint venture, but they said no, we will take 100 acres. That equation was, you know, very interesting to us. So we gave the property to them, but we did all the speed work from NOCs, everything we did. Though we have the expertise of constructing this kind of warehouses, but they wanted to do it. But it is coming up, alhamdulillah, it's coming, it's halfway through. First phase we gave, and they started developing. Second phase is going to happen in one week or so. And then another third phase is also there. All put together, there will be 100 acres of development in Oragadam. So these are all what we do. And then we have upcoming projects. This is in Porur, designed by Hafiz contractor. The elevation is not fully complete, but just showing a glimpse of it. There will be 171 apartments, all high rise. And this is another property we are going to develop in Gopalapuram. This is all in initial stage and the planning stage, but we have made the thing. And there is one more project called SAS Izmir in Ambattur that is also getting ready. And so we don't do too many projects. We do limited projects, but we focus and then we do it. So one of my clients was telling, you are like Amir Khan. Like, you do very limited project, but you do good project. Just a reference, you know, he said. And then, see, doing all these projects, we too have our own company principles. See, what has happened is, on this journey, we also committed a lot of mistakes, a lot of, hurdles were there. But we are able to overcome all those things. Mistakes and failures. If you see in Oxford Dictionary, for success, the opposite is failures. But in business, failures is not opposite to success. Failures and hurdles and problems, they are all part of success. I think most of you agree, because you are all stalwarts sitting in front of me. So it's all on our strides, and we came across all those things, and we have been doing this. And moreover, our the kind of business is such that people will always look at us, a developer, as a villain, as a negative person. I have never seen a cinema where a developer or a builder is shown as a hero. Always he's a villain. It's very difficult to prove to people that, no, there are good people, and there are, people who do good job and things like that. So how we have achieved that place? If you see our blogs, alhamdulillah, we all have all positive blogs, only no negative blogs. So how this has happened is, see, we care for our stakeholders. Clients are not only our stakeholders. As an individual, we have people all around. We are never an individual. We are never one single guy. So either as a family or business or whatever you take, we have stakeholders all around us. Like us, like in my business, we have clients as our stakeholders, government, workforce, landowners, vendors, employees, even nature also is a stakeholder. So as long as, we justify and we give justice to all these stakeholders, automatically, you will only see success. We might have hurdles, problems, everything is there. See, but one thing is, success is guaranteed. So this is how, our journey has been. This is how we have been doing it. And because I don't know, I'm running out of time. So we give highest quality possible for that whatever price we can give, at a very, very low price. Like Mr. Sharif Bhai said, it's all aesthetically done, very nice quality and all those things. But the challenge is, at what price we have to do that. That is the biggest challenge. See, if I can sell at 10,000, 20,000, 15,000, I can do a good building. But we are selling at our location, and our selling price is only 3,500 and 4,000. For 3,500, 4,000, whatever you have seen, these buildings are only 3,500 to 4,000 rupees per square feet. That is the biggest challenge. Okay. So one more thing I want to add there is, I have come across somebody telling me, like, our products are like Mercedes-Benz, but our prices are like Volkswagen. So it's like that. our building can sit even in Poets Garden or even in Boat Club Road as a building I'm talking about. Because of the location and things like that, okay, they are selling at lesser price, but they are as good as buildings over there. And then what we deliver, see, as I said, like, you know, we do landmark buildings, and then there are architecturally and thorough and effective, efficient planning. See, with due respect to architects, when people, they go there, they come out with some drawings. For example, if it is a multi-storied building, no, I'm talking about those days where it was 2.5 FSI. Immediately for a multi-storied building, they go for a basement where the developer has to put in so much money to come out of the project. But none of our buildings of 2.5 FSI multi-storied building has got basements because we can accommodate all the car parks on the ground level itself. And now the scenario slightly changed because the FSI is 3.25 and the house sizes have come down. So number of houses have gone up. But even then, I can do it in one basement. Maybe people will go for two basements. So there are, in the planning stage itself, there are so many things, you know, we can look into it. So where you can cut cost, you can give a better product to our clients. Then now, and if there is a piece of land, what we need to do, whether we need to go for a multi-storied building, even though it is eligible for multi-storied, it is wise to do a multi-storied building. If the market is good, if the turnaround period is good, you have to go for the maximum FSI. Now, all these years, the market was not good. So it's not necessary you have to go for the maximum FSI to achieve your profits. See, for an example, if I can tell you, if there is a property, the market is not very good, instead of going for a multi-storied building with the fullest FSI, earning 50 crores over a period of 10 years, you know, I will go for a smaller FSI building. I will earn 25 crores in 3 years. That's a better thing to do it. So there are many things we need to plan according to the market condition, according to the location and all those things. So these things, though, we do. And this is what maximum FSI at the minimal cost. There are places where you get premium FSI at half the price. Most of the members know, you should know about this. Your property, you might have property along the metro line. 500 meters from the metro line on either side, government gives 50% reduction on the premium cost, which is a very, very huge cost. Because if you see metro line properties are very expensive. If you're going for a premium FSI, you might have to shell out crores and crores of money for the premium FSI. And they give 50% off. While planning itself, you know, we should take that advantage. So people will not go for premium FSI at all. So all these things, you know, we do. And even tax laws, you do an affordable housing, we have a certain limits of apartment sizes. So when you do that, you have a tax exemption, and then you have to plan accordingly so that, you know, you can take that on the plan. Even in GST, well, see, 5% GST is what we need to collect from the clients. But if you plan it properly for that location, for that particular building, not all the buildings, when you do, it's only 1% GST to my clients. So it is easy to sell, it is affordable for them to buy. So all these things, you know, we look into it before we plan and before we launch a project. And for the future, we are thinking about, you know, 3D printing construction. We have our second generation coming up. Most of them are engineers, architects, my brother's children, my son. So they're all coming into this. They're all focusing on 3D printing construction and real-time 3D walkthrough for marketing. And more importantly, green building material, and then AI and machine learning in real estate. This is very, very important. This is something new. Our second generation is, they are studying the course also in that. So how to implement AI in marketing slowly now. Later on planning also, you know, they are going to do it. So alhamdulillah, we are on the right track, and we are we've been given a lot of awards and all those things. Though, okay, these are all awards we are getting, but our biggest award is on the social media, whatever review you see about our company is what I believe in. Finally, I would like to tell you to all the UEF members, whatever property you have, you want to develop, you're always welcome to our company. It is not on a business position. Just as knowledge sharing, you can call us, you can come here. We have a big team. We have youngsters also who knows more about the rules, regulations. So that, you know, when you, because property is what, you know, we have to really carefully, you know, we have to plan and develop. So you're all welcome to our company. Anytime you can SMS me or you can WhatsApp me, because if you call, maybe I may not know your numbers and I might think it's an unsolicited call because I'm getting a lot of, I might miss the calls. So if you WhatsApp, you know, you're always welcome. You can come. And that's it about, I think I've taken more time also. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Manuel. I think it's a fantastic presentation. I mean, you know, like I said previously, you know, we think that we know something about our members, and particularly you, you know, I always think we know something. But every time a presentation is made and the way you made it present, it's absolutely awesome. I mean, I've always wondered about that project in Guruvanjari. I mean, maybe you are aware, you know, we have a small farm there. I used to drive by, and that aesthetically, so aesthetically done. It's such a wonderful project, and I know it was your project, but it didn't strike me, you know, so well that it is your project. And all the other projects you've done, you know, all the comments are flowing into the chat room. Mashallah, it's really something to be very, very proud of. Thank you so much for, you know, sort of enlightening us with not just, what shall I say, the projects that you've done, but your whole ecosystem and your social consciousness, your pricing, the tax strategy, the IT strategy. I think everything is brilliant. And then, of course, the icing on the cake is, you know, you said you can, you know, you'll be willing to share it with all our members and to the community and whatnot. So that, I think, is really icing on the cake. And it goes without saying that when we can cooperate and, you know, share knowledge and everything, the pie is so large out there. Nobody else is going to eat into anybody else's pie, right? Because the market is just so big. Right, and a bunch of people here are not going to do it. So if we can share knowledge, for sure we'll be able to leverage and create a lot more value. Inshallah, you know, UEF will try its best to, you know, to facilitate all of this. So thank you so much, Manuel bhai. And I look forward to visiting your projects, and I'm sure many others would be willing, you know, would want to come and do it. And the last thing, I'm sure you'll give some very attractive prices to UEF members. So my request once again. So okay, thank you so much. Thank you, Manuel bhai. Thank you so much. Thank you, back to you, Kalim.
Very true, sir. Wonderful project, and especially the examples that he gave. Amir Khan, limited projects but quality work. Absolutely. Well said, Ali Sahab, which we have made a note, inshallah. Alhamdulillah. The next presenter for the day is going to be a new member called Mecton. You know, Mecton is a group which is basically started in the year 2005 as a recruitment, training, and placement organization. And so far, if I'm right, Ibrahim Sahab, they have done recruitment and placement for more than 8,000 people with the focus on Middle East. The other thing that Mecton Group is, their business interest is in diversified sectors. It is in construction. It is also in oil and gas. It is also into hospitality. They are also into food. They are also into technology. They are also into human resource and development. The way they work is basically, you know, joining hands with business houses, corporates, and especially with the government, and then they render their services. They're also partner with the government of India as far as a lot of initiatives is concerned. To share more about their group and what exactly they do, we have the Mecton Group founder and managing director, Mr. Syed Ibrahim Yaqub Saab. Over to you, Ibrahim Saab.
Assalamu alaikum to all. It's really a very, very proud moment for me to present my company into this niche group. And I don't know how to thank Mr. Sharif for inviting me earlier a couple of months ago to become a member of this group. It's been my dream, but somehow I don't know how to reach, where to, whom to meet to become a member into UEF group. So I met our president, Ahmad Bukhari, in Malaysia while I was attending the program of RISE Malaysia and I don't know whether he remember my face, and we all went for the prayer, for the Jummah prayer. So that time I was with him, and I had an opportunity to chit chat with him. So, but again, I couldn't introduce myself because I didn't get the bigger opportunity. Then, thank God, Alhamdulillah, now I have become a member. First of all, I am so thankful to be a member of this group. About me, if I have to tell, I am compared to the panelists and all the people in this, I am maybe the smallest person, smallest company, I can say. That I am a first generation entrepreneur who is from Erode, native of Erode, studied from a Tamil medium, and that too, first did my SSLC, then discontinued for about a year. Then again, I did my diploma in electronics. Then again, I did my engineering in GCT in part time with lot of hurdles, that I have come into this the business in 2005. I set up this company. Basically, I'm an electronics and communication engineer. I worked with a company called earlier BPL, and then Sanyo, then Philips, then last with Jerry Vergis, gave me the idea of overseas recruitment. I remember first time when I went to Philips, my passport was misplaced in Delhi by the agent. And I was waiting there for about 10 days. And I was like a beggar because I don't have any money. And I am just waiting along with the other workers and how these people are struggling, So that day I thought that, I wanted to start this business because especially from Muslim community, majority of the people, they like to go abroad. I mean, especially to the Gulf countries. So that dream started in 93. And then 2005, I set up this company, Emirates Overseas Recruitment Consultants. When I set up this company, I set up both in Dubai, that is for a marketing division. And then that was Mecton Resource Consultants. And then in India, we are a licensed recruitment company. We took the license. As of now, we have recruited around 15,000 people through Emirates Overseas Recruitment across various industries. So right from oil and gas, IT, ITS, facilities management, and almost in Dubai, you name any big company, we work with that. Can we go to the next slide? Yeah, next slide. So in this, what happened, now you can see here under DDU-GKY scheme, there are maybe 4,000 plus reputed agents, registered recruitment agents in India. But EORC is the only company is been awarded with DDU-GKY scheme for training and placement and then hiring. We are a captive employer. Under this scheme, we train, we recruit, and we hire directly to our company itself and to our clients. So we have been awarded DDU-GKY program. That means 100% funded by Government of India, that is 60% by Government of India. It's a state and central government under the Ministry of Rural Development. And we can go and bid this project anywhere. I can take the project across India, any state. And what they are offering is almost about 1 lakh rupee. So none of our candidate pay even a single penny to go to come to Gulf. So there is this thing like 62% should be for SCST, and then balance 38% can be backward. So my idea is all this 35%, 38%, I can use any community, but me being a Muslim, and I wanted to do something to my society. So this 32%, I wanted to hire Muslim candidates from the poorest to poor family. So that is what we have been doing. And that's again and again, I'm telling, we are the only company in India for overseas recruitment. This scheme has been awarded. So in recruitment, we deal with executive top level management, middle level management, and blue collars. Yeah, you can go to. So this Mecton training, what happened when I started doing the recruitment, you know, 5 years, right from 2005 to 2010, I was doing the recruitment. And then I understood the need for the training, where our candidates are lagging, why they have been underpaid. So that fine tuning need to be done. So we set up this training institute in Chennai, mainly to focus on E&I, electrical and instrumentation. This is the state of the art facility, what we are having, with the capacity of 75 candidates, accommodation, and it's our own building. And whatever in my life I earned, everything I have invested only into my business, into skill development, because that's very close to my heart. See, in the training, again, we identify certain categories. It is not that all the categories that always there is a demand. So I know, being in the industry for 15 years, which category has more demand, which category can be certified, and which category doesn't require any more interviews. So for example, now we are giving a training for scaffolding erection and inspection, and it is a TUV, third party certificate program. And once this certificate is there, no questions asked. It is like how there is a chartered accountant, no question is asked. For a medical professional, if he's a doctor, no question is asked. So similarly, rigors. And these are all the categories what we focus. And also in MECTON training, we are a NSDC partner, National Skill Development Corporation funded partner. I got the fund allocation of 2 crore, but I have utilized only 50 lakhs. The reason is because of the pandemic, it got approved last year, but after the pandemic, I could utilize only 50 lakh. Government is chasing me to use the balance fund also to set up more and more institutions and to give the training. So far in this training only, we have trained and placed 8,000 people. I have hired to my own company. I have a manpower contracting company here in Qatar. So whomsoever I train, I recruit, I hire directly to my own company. So this we call as human, MECTON human assets, where we do the contract hire. So contract hire means, you know, like companies like oil and gas, Qatar Petroleum, Qatar Gas, we call them as operating companies. These operating companies, they don't hire the people directly. They go through contractors, manpower contractors. We are listed contractors of QP, QG, and recently now we have signed an agreement with Shell Qatar. So these are all the projects where our people are working. So these are all the services what we are into. So we do contract hire, we do recruitment selection, training and trade test facility. And we also do management consulting in terms of anybody wants to come and set up a company in Qatar. And I've been in this country for 15 years. I understand the dynamics, how this country works. It's really, really, I'm telling, this is the potential Gulf country, I can say. I worked in Dubai, I worked in Saudi, but again, Qatar is the potential. Still, I am telling, it's a virgin market. So this 1 year ago, I started this division with a company called SiteServe. I understood the potential for this because now in Qatar, there is a project called North Field Expansion, which is a 30 billion project. Whatever the current capacity they have, they are expanding by 50%. So already they have the train, up to train 7 they have, 8 they have, now 10, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. So 5 more trains they are increasing. So the peak manpower requirement is almost about 80,000 people. So then I understood the need for the support services. So first we started with the recruitment, then manpower supply, and then this is the porto cabin we are now supplying, and we got the contract with the Shell Qatar. Yeah, go to the next slide. So these are all our porto cabins, modular porto cabins, which we are importing from Turkey, and we are renting it out to oil and gas industries. These are all the few pictures, and also we are into event management. So for any kind of event, and we supply tower lights and fencing, and then hoardings, barriers, these are all the things we supply. We have about 1 lakh square meter yard here in Qatar. And this is my very key business now, which is just 6 months before, during the pandemic, I again understood this: when 80,000 people are going to work, how much will be the scaffolding requirement? I am supplying scaffolder, for example, an hourly rate of 20 rial per hour. But when I supply the scaffold along with the material, and then the requirement, I mean, you know, it's a huge business. So just it's a 6 months old company, and we have been pre-qualified for the tendering along with Shell Qatar. The tender is going to be in October. This I made a JV with a company called Al Layth, and which is a Dubai-based company. But again, the holding company is from South Africa. So I am going to use all their technology for scaffolding, and we are bidding for a 50 million project in Shell. So these are all the types of scaffolding that we are, for the oil and gas, that we are going to use it. Okay, so then comes the Mecton oil field supply. We are actually approved vendor of Basra Gas in Iraq. So 1 year ago, one of my partner, who is Dutch, who was heading Iraq Basra Gas. So now he retired and he has become my partner in Iraq. And we got the entry into Basra Gas, supplying of valves, fittings, flanges, pipes. So these are all the things, and we are making OEM partners. And there is a company called JC Valves, which is a Spain company. They have their operation in Middle East as well as in India. So we are the exclusive stockist for the valves, JC Valves for oil and gas. And we are supplying these valves to Basra Gas, Iraq. So these are all the other components what we source from the local market, or from UK, or from, you know, other countries. So Mecton Energy Plus, this is again a specialized division. In this division, what we do services work at height, you know, rope access services. This is a specialized work what we do, anywhere where up to 100 meters, 200 meters height. On that, the welding is done, or on that sandblasting is done, or painting is done. And we were involved into during this Qatar here on the stadiums, almost all the stadiums, we supplied almost about 600 plus people on doing the rope access services. So which is a very highly specialized services. Yeah, now this is the youngest company, 1 year old company, and I would request my partner, Mr. Raj, to give the presentation on tea machine, what we wanted to do with the tea machine, where I am very much you know, delighted to associate with our present engineering university. And I had a two level meeting with Mr. Syed Muhammad Buhari. He was so impressed, and he told us that he will introduce to the board members and vice chancellors of present engineering university. And this I am looking for a JV with Crescent Engineering, and this is a huge project, inshallah. It is mind-blowing. And Raj, you please take over.
Ibrahim sir, you have just 1 or 2 minutes, so you need to ensure that it is being done.
Yeah. Raj, please.
Yeah. So hi, this is Raj Kumar. So good morning to all. So I would like to complete the next few slides in 2 minutes, couple of minutes I would like to complete. Yeah, so you can walk through directly to a tool which we are developing, and almost it's in a finishing stage. You can walk through the slide, tmachine.ai. Next. The next. Yes. See, actually the solution what we are proposing here is, so we are developing an e-learning platform. So where, assume that a dedicated teaching mechanism is there for individual candidate, also a self-learning platform. So which means self-learning itself, a kind of enthusiastic learning skill. So one should have, actually almost all the research scholars are having such kind of self-learning skill. Okay, so what if dedicated teaching mechanism and a self-learning platform is combined with the artificial intelligence background, how it transforms the the ordinary talent, ordinary student into a skilled talents. That is what this software does actually. And also it recommends these are the talented people on so and so things using this Teamation A.AI applications. Okay, so once we log in, we are developing the purpose of this one is actually it's a dedicated AI tutor to an individual training, and it teaches software programming on its own pace actually. Okay, so these are the software programming compilation tools, and it also recommends what is this grasping skill, coding skills, bug fixing things and sustainable memory, all those things it recommends to the employer so that employer can identify the dynamic software programmer. Okay, the next. The features are actually, these are task-driven learning techniques, and we use first principle thinking method. Even now, the great scholar person like Elon Musk kind of person are recommending the conventional, instead of going with the conventional method, why can't we go with the first principle thinking method? Which means we display one sentence and we question the trainee what the sentence means actually. So we just go with the first principle, what he understands, then we explain slowly one by one. So this is a kind of a learning methodology, and each and every task is a kind of challenging. So let's say for example, for Python, for a basic programming, so 10 tasks we used to give, and if they complete the 10 tasks and the knowledge graph kind of things and all will be generated like this, what they know before Teamation, what they learned from the Teamation, what they're yet to be learned from Teamation using this one. So we he himself can learn on its own. Not only that, so feedback driven kind of things and all that. For example, it also measures his honesty, dedication, hard work, self-confidence, patience and punctuality, and it recommends the same kind of qualities to the employers. To start with, the version 1.0 we supports Java and Python, and anyone who chooses that Java and Python, they will become a kind of dynamic software programmer in the sense data structures, algorithms, big O analysis, they will become a kind of expert. The people who learn from Indian Institute of Technology kind of institutions or big institutions in India, so they are master in this data structures, algorithms and big O analysis. So this self-paced 50 coding based task is the one which we are having all these kind of qualities. And so as I mentioned in the previous things, knowledge graph, all interpersonal skills, software skills, all those things are kind of given in a kind of dashboard. It helps candidates, and it also helps the employers to identify the right stuff. Sorry, I have only very couple of minutes, so I was going very fast. So in the next month or in the next presentations, we will explain with other more details. Okay, and thanks for giving time for this walkthrough on this Teamation.ai web application tool.
Thank you so much, the president and then the coordinators for giving us. Maybe we have taken 1 or 2 minutes more. I'm really sorry for that, and thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Sridharan. I still remember our trip in KL. We went for prayer, Friday prayer, and each one had to go in one corner. Imran was also there from Tirupur.
Yes.
Yeah. So thank you very much. Of course, we didn't know all these wonderful things that you're doing, and it's really, really heartwarming, with all the employment opportunity that you are trying to provide for people from Tamil Nadu. I'm sure all our education institutions y'all can cooperate closely, because you are in the recruitment business, they are in the supply business. And of course, our wish list is these high quality talent should stay back in Tamil Nadu itself. And we need to take Tamil Nadu into a $1 trillion economy. And if all our best talent is exported to Qatar and Saudi, that's a bit of a brain drain, but that's a different issue altogether. But if we can somehow cooperate and do that happen both ways, not just overseas, but also in India, in Tamil Nadu, I think it will be of great value. So, Jazakallah, Sridharan Bhai and Mr. Rajkumar, for the nice presentation. Thank you so much. So, back to you, Kalim.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Alhamdulillah. Very good to know all these things that you are doing as a group, Ibrahim sir. Very happy to know that each and every member in the last 1 month, getting so many news that one member is coordinating with one member and trying to see how they can connect and do business. You talking to SM Bukhari sir, the one you updated, I was so happy to know about it. Alhamdulillah. The next presenter for the day is going to be our member called Wings Food and Chemicals, a company that is into sourcing and delivering spices, dry fruits, and herbs in a sustainable way. A company that was established hardly before 4 years. They have their factory in Kadalur, and then their sales office, one in Tamil Nadu, the other one in Karnataka. To share more about it, we have the managing director of Wings Food and Chemicals. Over to you, Khader Ali Bhai, to share what your company is all about.
Thanks a lot, Sarim Bhai, for the brief introduction. I'm delightful and thankful to all AF members, and a special thanks to President Ahmed Buhari for this wonderful opportunity. Because in this world, network is very, very important. So creating a platform for the network is a great opportunity. So for that, I am so much thankful to the EF members and the president. So before going into my presentation, so I have two versions in my career. The version one, I started my career as an employee. In the year 2001, after my education, I came to Chennai. I started my career with Eureka Foods as a sales executive in sales and marketing platform, where I learned sales and marketing. So after the Eureka Foods, and I moved into a banking sector, Standard Chartered, and after banking sector, I moved into Tata Groups, then Murugappa Group. In the Murugappa Group, I was working as a regional manager. When I was working with Murugappa Group, I thought of doing business. I got inspired about entrepreneurship, so I thought of doing business. So the moment I decided to move into the business, my next question is, what we have to do? Because this is a big challenge and a question to every new entrepreneur. So if you want to do the business, what you have to do that, what you have to choose. That time I was sitting in the Paris Daros, that is my office. Most of you aware, Murugappa Group got a headquarters in Chennai, Paris Daros. Behind the Daros, there is a market, chow carpet market. In the chow carpet market, there's a wholesale trades are happening. So what I do, like whenever I get a time, I used to visit this chow carpet market. I started meeting people and I developed the contact, and I understand the dynamics of the trading. Then I decided to move into trading business. In the year 2015, I decided to resign my job. That was not a big decision. That was not a small decision. That was a big decision, because leaving such a comfortable job, because when I was in the Murugappa Group, I was a DGM and my CTC was around 25 lakhs. So after consulting with my family, I had taken a decision. Then I started my own company. In the 2016, I started the trading business in a smaller way, where like I learned like how to trade the business. I started trading with the domestic product. Then finally I came to what product are coming to India and what product we can export to another countries. Then started moving to foreign countries for the experience. So now we have a equipped company. From this company, we importing various spices, dry fruits, and other herbal product to the India and selling into the wholesale segment. So Wings Food, it's a global trader. So what we do, we have developed the very good network in overseas countries and created a wider network and created a sourcing point in the country like Vietnam, Indonesia, Madagascar, and other African countries. From those places, we buy raw materials from the farmers or agri product. Then process, clean, grade. Then we bring it to India and we sell it to India. In India, we have a factory set up in Kadalur where all the processing, grading process taken place in that place. Then we have a sales counter in Chennai and Bangalore. From those places, we are selling into the wholesale markets. Where we sell? For selling, we have three platforms. Number one, we are selling into the wholesale hub. Many of you know business happening through the wholesale market. Say example, in India, there are different states. Every state have a wholesale hub. In Tamil Nadu, Chennai is the wholesale hub for the product. In Chennai, we have opened a sales office. We started penetrating Tamil Nadu market. We started supplying to all the wholesale buyers who buy spices, dry fruits, and herbals in a big volume. Then we started focusing the company, manufacturing company. Manufacturing, there are the three segments: food manufacturing company and cosmetic manufacturing company, and the pharma based Ayurvedic based pharma companies, where they buy the lot of food products and the spices and herbals. Those companies we have started supplying. Himalaya is our client. Sakti, Achi, Everest is our client. Also, we are supplying to the Britannia in this platform. And recently, there are new corporates coming into the food industry, because food industry is the evergreen industry. So many corporates emerging companies started in coming into the food industry, like Big Basket, D-Mart, Walmart, Flipkart, Amazon. So we become a registered vendor with them. We started supplying product to them. So in these platforms, we are selling this product. When I talk about my company, so as I said earlier, 2016, I started in this company in a smaller way. In the year 2017, I registered a private limited company, started this company with two employees. Currently, there are around 50 employees working in this company. Our annual turnover is around 50 crore, and we are the limited company. Yes, like we are recognized company, we are recognized importer and exporter, and known company in India. Now we are certified from various boards of India, like Spices Board, ABEDA, FSSAI, and we are also registered MSME player, and we are registered the marine importer, the product player. So these are our certifications. So when I talk about the product lines, we are the major players of green cardamom supplier. We source from the India market, and we are the very strong in the food chemicals. We import from the China and Japan, and other spices we import from Indonesia, Madagascar, and African countries, and cassia from the Vietnam, and dry fruits we are importing almond from California, cashew nuts we are importing from African countries, and other herbal product, almost all the African countries as well as the Southeast Asia countries we are importing. So our supply chain, so our secret is, generally we used to buy from the farmers. Through the farmers, we take the support of the collector, and the collector will give to the exporter, and the exporter will give it to the importer through broker. The broker we will appoint to ensure the quality and other terms. And again, through a broker, we move the stocks into the process unit, and we will sell it to the customers. This is our process, the supply chain. So rock cashew nuts we are importing from African countries. Okay, we are importing to India. It is being processed in our factory and the packing, and we are selling to the market. Likewise, walnut importing from Chile, and almond, it is coming from California, processing in our factory and selling to the customers. Spices, Vietnam, Madagascar, and other African countries, we are bringing to our factory, processing, packing, and selling to India market. In this point, I wanted to give you small input about global agri trade, the process. Maybe like it might helpful to the EF members. The operating model of global trade is very simple. Unlike another product, spices and dry fruits are highly volatile products in the market. Every time the prices and demand will change time to time. So generally, investors, they buy the product in the harvesting period, and they will stock the spices and the dry fruit at the low prices. When market increases, people used to sell in the market according to the demand at high price. So this is the model where many investors and many stockists doing profitable business. Say example, the poppy seed in the year 2019, the importing cost was 500 rupees. Can anyone assume what is the current market price? So the current market price, it's 1500 rupees. You might think like, okay, 600, 700 rupees appreciation, but current market price, it is 1500 rupees. So everyone can do the spice trading business, but you should have a deeper knowledge in this agri trade. I just tell you the elements of the agri trade business model. To do the business, first you should have a complete agri trade knowledge. That is simple concept. The formula is W3, what to buy, when to buy, where to buy. If you know that, you can start the product, you start buying the product. To buy the product, you should have a complete network. Network in the sense you should have a reliable contact, because a lot of scams happening in the import and export business. If you have a wider connect in the world, you can buy the product. And for holding the stocks, you should have a financial capacity. If you have a financial capacity, you can buy the product in the harvesting period, you can hold the stocks, and you can start selling to the market as and when demand starts. So marketing capacity, yes, in the demand period also, to sell the product, you should have a marketing capacity. So this is the very simple platform, but if you can react in the right way, it is a very good platform to make a profitable business. Why I'm giving input in this forum, because many of the EF members, they are scattered around in the world. So they have a wider network and they have very good connect in all the places. If they want to come into agri-trade business, yes, it is the right platform. You can do the profitable business. In case like if you want any assistance or any details about the product, you can anytime, like, you can call me, you can take my assistance. So this is I'm in this slide, the harvesting calendar, just for a glance. So which country, which product, which month it is coming, just for a glance. Okay, so the industry opportunities. Unlike other industry, the food industry is an evergreen industry, because the growing population in the world is a direct opportunity for the food industry. Every year food industry is growing. Say example, during this COVID time also, all other business gone down, but only the industry which grown is the food industry. The compound annual growth rate is 8.3% in the forecast of 2025. Our ongoing projects, currently we are buying from the world and we are supplying to India wholesale markets. Currently we have a sales offices in Bangalore. We are covering entire Karnataka market, and we have a sales office in Chennai. Through the Chennai office, we are covering entire Tamil Nadu market. Our processing unit placed in the Kadalur. We are also, like, we are going for the expansion to all the mini dry fruit product. In the near future, we have a plan to start a wholesale hub, this sales point in Mumbai, Hyderabad, Kolkata. Inshallah, shortly, like, we will open branches those places. Mumbai is the main place which is controlling entire India market. That is the headquarters for trade hub in India. Also, we have a plan to open a branch in either Dubai or Singapore, which will be the trade hub for world global trading. The simple concept is, across the world, we have wider network, we have wider connect with all the farmers. We know, like, who can offer which product at what price. If you have a trading office in Dubai or Singapore, through that trading office, we can sell it to the another buyers who are sitting in the world. We know many buyers also. So we know where to buy and where to sell. So if you have a trading office in the Dubai or Singapore, it is a simple concept. We can buy from the farmers, so from the origin countries, and we can sell it to the sellers. This project also, we are working on that. Inshallah, if required, like, I will take EF support on this. Since, like, EF have a wider connect, so EF would be the right platform to support us. So also, we are working out in the B2C business model, where we are trying to launch dry fruit snacks, a dry fruit drink, and other instant foods. We are working on that. The project is very initial level. We are going to use the platform to market our product, the e-commerce platform, also the chain store. Also, we are working on the mobile retail vehicle concept, because now there are many gated communities where those people depending this local supermarket. In the local supermarket, and the prices of the food products are very, very high. So what we are going to do that, we are going to set up a vehicle showroom where we will display all our product. and we will bring those vehicle to the doorsteps of gated community as well as the business complex. So whoever want to buy the product, they can buy the product at the wholesale market price. This project also we have started working on that. Inshallah, in a short way, like we will launch this model. So there are few pictures about our warehousing and the product, just for a glance. So this is my contact details in case anyone like wants to start, because in the society, if you want to help others, yes, like we can show the way to other people. The agri trading business is very simple. If you do the business in a correct way, you can make the profitable business, and you can easily grow. If anybody wants to come into the agri business, inshallah, you just keep in touch with me. I am ready to give you any input and the assistance. So once again, thank you, Mr. Sharif. Thank you, President, for this wonderful opportunity. Also, I thank all the members for this great opportunity. Thank you all.
Thank you, Kadrali Bhai.
Thank you.
You were mentioning that you are in Murugappa Group and. You were in Saukarpet, you know, so between the Chettiars and the Marwadis, you know, I think you really learned the lesson very hard. And, you know, so you seem to have really learned a lot. And, you know, in the 4 or 5 years to cover so much ground, it's not easy. I think you've done absolutely brilliantly, and number of offices and the spices, and it's very, very interesting. And thank you very much for your offer to also support all our members for the learning. Inshallah, maybe I'll come and drop by your office sometime when I'm in Paris. So thank you very much for the presentation. Lovely presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
So back to you, Kaleem.
Yes, sir. Thanks a lot, Kadar Bhai. I could already see some messages trying to connect with you, Sadat Sam. We will ensure that you both get connected and see how it's a win-win for both of you. Thanks a lot once again for the presentation. You know, we all know that one of the key objective of UAF is basically starting 45 ECR centers. And through these 45 ECR centers, target to, you know, have 4,500 entrepreneurs being created. Because ECR is the buzzword. Wherever you go, you hear ECR, all about startups, innovation, all those things. In an attempt to do so, we are visiting all our 45 affiliated institutes, and we had the opportunity to visit one of the EIs at Tirchi called Master Group. When we went there, there were a lot of lessons to be learned, alhamdulillah. And to give a small nutshell about Master Group, I would say that originally part of MAM Group, and Master Group currently has got 3 institutes within it. It is one place where you will also see just not the skilling, learning and study is being done, but lot of aspects and qualities that are required for success is being mastered in this institute. When we went there, I would rather say that we learned one of the important life lesson aspect of how taking care of your guest. To share more about this master group, I would call upon the correspondent and secretary, Fatima Batul, madam.
So assalamu alaikum to the esteemed guest dignitaries of the UAF. It's indeed a great privilege and pride for me to present here on behalf of Master Group of Institutions. So I would like to thank Brother Ahmed, our esteemed president, for giving us this wonderful opportunity to share the insights from our end on how do we build a successful institution. So I would just want to talk about the genesis, as Mr. Sharif Bhai said, the genesis of MAM. It was started, the Maluk Education, Health and Charitable Trust was started with the leadership of Alhaj M. Abdul Majid, my father-in-law, and Mr. Haji Muhammad Nizam and Haji Muhammad Maluk Muhammad and the sons. It's a family-owned trust which was started in the year 1999. And by God's grace, by the rahmat of the Almighty, while we started the institution with 77 students and 13 faculty members, with the trustees' hard work and the quality that we wanted to impart, the institution grew to a group of 10 institutions by the end of 2010. So that is the genesis of the MAM group of institutions. And so for better administrative reasons, in the year 2014, while that was in India, especially in Tamil Nadu, when there are a lot of institutions which grew, the demand was more, the supply was more and the demand was less. And there was a lot of challenges that all institutions faced. And that was the time when the board and our management decided to give independent entity to the trustees to choose and work independently on the institutions. We got our share of three institutions, namely the MAM College of Engineering and Technology, MAM School of Architecture, and MAM Business School, in order to build or create an individual identity. We branded our three institutions as the Master Group of Institution. So what does Master mean? Master means MAM Academy of Science, Technology, and Research. And this is a management of the Master Group, ably guided by Dr. M.A. Maluk Mohammed, a doctorate from IIT Madras. And this is me, Mrs. Fatima Batul Maluk. I'm an MBA graduate and I've done my executive education from the Indian School of Business. So with that, we strongly believe that for any institutions, the right people, right mentors play a vital role in growing it to the way that we want. So we first chose the governing council members from with our own networks from the IITs, the NITs, and we had also the industry connect where we had the governing council. I'm not going to share more about the infrastructure or what is being here, because obviously any institution needs to have an infrastructure, labs, and all those facilities. I want to just share these nuggets of knowledge on the culture, because we feel highly successful organizations are built thoughtfully with a culture that is well-defined and which is made to percolate among every stakeholder in the organization. So we do have our own culture. What is our culture stands for is we started imbibing these three P's as our culture. One is the purpose, the process, and the people. Why are we doing this? What is the mission, vision, and value of whatever work we do? Point number two is on the process, which should be well-defined, and how are we going to do that? And third is the right people that we are getting associated with. So we believe that a clearly process-driven organization will start with this purpose of our mission, vision, and values. I would like to just elaborate a bit on all the three. Point number one is our vision. Our vision is to emerge as a nationally reputed, accredited, and autonomous technical institution with the state-of-art infrastructures. And this is our mission, to deliver knowledgeable, skill-based education and enable our students to build a professional career for them. So we wanted to start the state-of-art laboratories and enhanced infrastructure for improving the co-learning. And again, we also want to provide input to the faculty and the students to involve in more projects which are innovative and foster the culture of growth and research. So these are the values. Any successful business should have values behind it. So we have these two as our prime values, the student success and the business success. Student success comes in terms of curricular, co-curricular, extracurricular, and career-ready professions. We don't want to create our students and say we offer you jobs, but we want to create them to be more knowledgeable. And second is on the business success, for that is how any organization survives. On quality admissions and quality faculty retentions, the incubations and research and consultancy projects. I want to take some time while I'm talking about this completely, because this is the throughput process of what we've been working. And this is a prioritized design and implement. This is the 7-stage process, as I was talking about the process. Any organization, for our organizations, we have three metrics. One is on the academic results. The second is on the admissions. And third, on the entrepreneurship or the growth of the students. So anything that doesn't end or doesn't give outcomes on these three, we don't take that as a project. But any project that we take undergoes this seven-step process, which I would want to highlight to this esteemed guest here. The first is the mission, vision, values, and setting up a trajectory or the priorities of what we wish to do. That is the direction of the project. Second comes the priority. This is the step one and step two. Priority means on a quarterly measure, something that is not measurable is not achievable is what we truly believe. And this, the first and second stage is very, very essential for us to start moving forward with any project. The third one is on the OMMK, which we call as the outcomes, measures, methods, and the KSM. So outcomes is what is the outcome that's going to be created out of this? What are the matrices that we are going to see or we are going to identify or measure out of this particular work that we've done? The third is the method or the steps. We write it down totally, and KSM is any root cause analysis and any improvements that are needed. So this is the third stage. And after this, we have the fourth, fifth, sixth, and the seventh stage that we go on is to plan, implement based on the timelines. And fifth is the sprintly implementations and review. A sprintly meeting is nothing but a bi-monthly meeting with the senior leadership team with all the matrices that have been properly aligned, and they give a presentation out with the data as to what they have achieved. And deploying is something that we take forward to our students and teachers and try to impact them by doing a pilot study. A pilot study in the sense of working with a measured set of probably one classroom or probably one working out that project with a group of students. So that is how we measure or maximize the level one reach. And everywhere, wherever the throughput works in a way that the first and second stages are in the quarterly plan, and we start having the sprintly reviews from the third, fifth, and the seventh stage here. And just to make a note of it, the L1 measures or whatever we get is directly connected to the student success, the business success, which is our goal of the end outcome of the process that we normally want to adapt. And wherever, only when the stage before it is achieved, we will be able to proceed to the next stage. And if there are bottlenecks, we normally do a root cause analysis. And everything is properly defined, written down, and there are data and matrices. We don't go with the sweeping statements or just like that. So this is it. So again, as I said, the third component that we work with is the people. So who we hire and how we retain. They say that the people whom you are associated with plays a greater role in bringing your organization or working on the vision of it. That's how we hire people, and we look forward for these qualities in the master zone to imbibe with the master culture, to work with passion, talent, and trust. So these are the things that we have, that we train them the moment they enter into the campus. We choose them based on all these parameters. There is a meticulously planned work of how we choose people and how we check whether they are the right persons to be working along with us. This is we look while we hire people and start working. So again, I don't want to take too much of time. I'm just running through it. This is a master culture to sum up. With the purpose of why we are doing this exercise, are we getting the student success and the organization success? Are we, making our stakeholders happy on that? Then the process, as I told, it's to prioritize, design, implement, check it forward, and then take it. And the people, do we have the right people with passion, talent, and trust? And are we choosing such right people? Are we imbibing this culture to everybody in the institution is what we've been working throughout. And to state the few best practices that we have done so far, this master group is the one in Trichy, which has been mentored by NIT Trichy. And we take guidance, we take their support and expertise, and we work on a hub and spoke system. What is hub and spoke system means is to disperse knowledge and to encourage the best practices. Spokes are nothing but additional services that we give to our faculty for their self-improvement. They attend a lot of development programs, trainings, and all that. And we also allow for the inter-Hamlet information sharing as a part of the NIT's mentee. So we're one of the prestige institutions who's the mentee institution for them. And we do share technical knowledge, research, and many other things, which is mutually beneficial for both. And again, I would like to reiterate on this point of what are the collaborations we have with institutes of excellence. Yes, we've been the NPTEL study center of IIT Madras for long, and this enables a lot of e-learning courses. We have a metrics where we measure the students and the staff's performance. They have to take these courses while they are with us, and they have to keep improvising and improving on their knowledge component. Point number two is we are the remote center of IIT Mumbai, and we have the National Mission on Education through the ICT. We have dispersed the spoken tutorial centers for schools in Tamil Nadu, and we've been the nodal center for the virtual labs from IIT Kanpur as well. And I'm so proud to state Bennett University, which is, we are the zonal partners for leading India in the AI mission of the Bennett University. Now, this is one special initiative that we have with PALS. I'm sorry, PALS is a Pan India Alumni Leadership Series of the IIT. And we've been working with PALS for quite some time, and our students have indeed achieved a lot more laurels. We get the mentorship, we get to go through their complete series of, our students go into the IIT campus and they get the privilege of doing a lot of work with them. And there's a lot of benefits that we've reaped. Our research projects have been taken forward by them, and we've kind of taken our institution's research a bit forward with that collaboration for the past 3 or 4 years. Now, the latest in addition to us is the IIT Madras Incubation Cell, and which is a very, very important thing because we do have our entrepreneurial ecosystem very strong. So this IIT M Incubation Center, the cell, is going to be to make sure both the IIT Madras and the master will work together and provide incubation and support facilities to entrepreneurial ventures. We are having Dr. Ashok Jhunjhunwala here in the next 2 weeks to inaugurate it, and we already have few projects that we are working. So the IIT Madras Incubation Center will also help master in setting up the processes on incubation and the startup selections and all that. And there'll be an access to the startup engine platform, and master will be tracking and managing the incubates. So we'll be sharing on the equity branding and all that part. So these are the entrepreneurship avenues, is to introduce or induce innovation and entrepreneurial orientation to our students. And we just focus on 3 thrust areas: innovation, entrepreneurship, and outreach programs. So reaching out to the students right from the first year is what we deem as our success. And we have a lot of experts that have been invited to share their knowledge. And of course, we set up the enterprises, the incubators, seeding strength, and angel investors. And we strengthen the function through our long-term and short-term plans. So this is, we do have a very strong industry connect to utilize the high knowledge and research. And as you know, AACT has now made it mandatory to have internships. And we need to fill in the lacunae that lies between the education and the industry. So we have a TCS center within the campus, and we have also signed a few MOUs. We are working very closely with many industries. So to sum up, I would say, what do we do is we ideate, interact, and consolidate. How do we ideate? We have through the lectures and camps and all the trainings and awareness that we create. We interact with many more people outside international, national, and with esteemed organizations like the UEF and CII, and we are a part of all these things. We interact and we consolidate. We consolidate through a proper process, planning, return outcomes, measures, methods, and we also have a weekly monitoring and all that happening. So this is our vision for 2030. So I hope, inshallah, it will come true. And I would wish to state my special thanks and this one to the Almighty for bringing us together. My husband also have, he's been out in this entrepreneurial journey with the twin digital healthcare sector, where they've reversed diabetes by using technology, and I'm really, really thankful for UEF brother Ahmed for bringing us the connect through which I'm sure they'll become a unicorn as well. We are using the expertise from his end. We take his guidance totally, and we want to create quality students, because there is a myth that says there are more engineers across the world, and there's a downfall of people choosing engineering education. It's not so. It's like if we give them the right education, if we take the network's strength and start working together, I'm sure we will be able to provide really strong engineers who will be building the nation, and we shall have a lot more benefits together. And I would like to invite all the esteemed people present here, any organizations, companies or colleges, whatever it is, we would be grateful. We'd be very happy to collaborate with you in order to make sure that we have mutually benefit because of this union. So I'm really, really glad and thankful for this. I didn't want to bring the regular infrastructures and the campus, because any institution cannot survive without an infrastructure, lab facilities, and the rest of it. We just wish to bring forth to you on the culture, the process, the purpose, and how we are planning. And with this thought, I'm leaving the floor open, and thank you so much for the wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Batul. Always a dynamic presentation, very, very well presented. And if I think with your permission, I'll have to tell the rest of the audience about your Himalayan treks, where you had taken Brother Maluk, much to his reluctance. So they had gone to the Himalayas for trekking, and Sister Batul, as you know, she was also chosen by Ernst & Young, if I'm not mistaken, to do some, so as very few people in India which were selected, she's one of them. So I'm very happy that, group and Maluk Brothers group is very closely associated with UEF. Queen's Health is something that we are absolutely delighted and proud of. I'm sure that Mamset will, be creating a lot more entrepreneurs. I remember discussing with Brother Maluk, and he said he wants to bring the whole Silicon Valley culture, IIT, and all those things into Trichy, and of course, which will also benefit the rest of the community. So we are really, really looking forward to it. I'm sure you have your financial targets, much like IIT, 10,000 crores is the valuation of the companies which are being churned out by IIT. You must be aware of that. And also BITS Pilani. Both of them have created companies from their campuses, which are valued currently at 10,000 crores. And we can imagine if all our institutions are able to create this type of value, it would be phenomenal value for the whole community. So thank you very much, Sister Batul, for the wonderful presentation. We look forward to coming and visiting you in person. Thank you so much.
Anybody quickly, if you have one or two questions, we have only time for that. Quickly.
Dr. Maluk. Where are you?
Assalamu alaikum, President. How are you?
Where are you? We have to find you now.
I'm there, President. I'm so happy that yesterday, Toby, the founder CEO of Cleveland, has joined as one of the board of directors. It's a great, great value addition for Twin. Twin is doing extremely well.
Wonderful, wonderful.
Brother Ahmed, I always tell him this. I'm sorry to interrupt you, Maluk. Okay, I always tell him that we owe a lot to UEF for the connect, the whole thing that you people have just taken. This is like, I keep telling him, like, it's really great thing. I would like to just register my heartfelt gratitude here for bringing these connects for us. Thank you so much.
Second present, but for you and UF, this is not true. Jahangir keeps repeatedly telling that. Every time he tells that.
I'm just wondering how much shares UF has in Twins now, you know, so we are calculating, Doctor.
It is there, President. The commitment is commitment. There is sure.
Inshallah. No, this is, how do I put it? The other day I was mentioning to somebody, Twins becoming a unicorn soon is a pride for each and every member of the community. Because, you know, so we are seeing unicorns as if they're somewhere outside, you know. It's not that our people have done it. And for, you know, for UEF, and I'm thankful to all our members, all the supporters, because we wouldn't have been able to arrange without the support of each and every member, the office bearers, each and every participation. That's how we're able to do what we're able to do. And really to see that, you know, Twins doing wonderful is really, really very, very heartwarming. And also the service that it does to community. 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 patients treated, reversal of diabetes. And to know that we have been a small part of it is very soul satisfying, to say the least. So thank you so much.
President, to add, our randomized control trial is proven amazingly great, world's top outcomes, just not the diabetes. We are able to reverse cholesterol, BP, liver, multiple things. And we had published officially in American Diabetic Association, and we are moving towards making this as a standard of care. And inshallah, by the second quarter of 2022, your dream of Twin Health becoming a unicorn is sure. Nothing can stop us, inshallah.
Inshallah. We're really looking forward to it. And I'm sure the spillover effect will be there in MAMSET and other EIs, and, you know, because the learning that we will derive from what, you know, Twins is going through, and to get that knowledge back into the UEF and to the rest of the community will have a huge multiplier effect. And this is what we're really hoping to achieve, inshallah. Maybe next time we will try the session for, make it 1 hour and see how it goes. So, because I was very impressed with Mohammed Ibai, you know, how he conveyed the whole thing in less than 10 minutes. The whole presentation was made in such a brilliant manner. So it is possible. So thank you very much. If there's nothing else, I think we'll wrap up with this month's session. Thank you all for participating. I think we had record participation today. I saw there was about 56 people. So thank you very much. Inshallah, for next month, we'll also have some more interesting presentations. So thank you all, and Assalamu alaikum.